Hey guys, thanks for watching. Make sure to like and subscribe, and let's just jump right in. And to begin, I'm just going to show some of the assets I created in Blender. I'll leave them available to download in the description below so you guys can follow along. First, I made the ball. I just applied a subdividing surface modifier 2 times to the default cube and then applied smoothing to it. This is the jelly, the slime that we're going to be using. I colored him blue and made him a little slimy. Now when it's in real rendered mode, it doesn't look as slimy. We could probably fix that at some point. I mean, if we have to. It looks nice to me. I like how simple it was to make these guys. This is the goal that I made. Very simple, mostly cylinders. The hardest part was making the net, but I actually found a really good tutorial for that. It was how to make a net on Blender. It was by the Blender master, Green Pillow. I've included the link to his video in the description below, so check out if you're interested in learning how to make a net. You can download the assets in the description below. What we're doing first is starting off with an empty Unity project, and then we're going to start doing what we do best, programming the game. The first things first, I'm going to make the ground and line it up with the camera. We want to make sure we have a good angle on the ground. This game's going to be a 2D game with 3D assets, so it's an interesting style to say the least. Most of it isn't difficult. It's pretty straightforward and some good practice. It's nothing like FIFA. It's going to be pretty close. So I'm just expanding out the ground a little bit, bringing it down and making sure it's level with everything. Next, I'll create a folder for the Blender files and pop them all into the Unity editor. You don't even have to export them as FBXs if you don't want to. The cool thing about Blender is if you want to import it directly into Unity, it's pretty good at supporting Blender files. Now, exporting to FBX is probably a good idea. I mean, exporting anything is good, but using the Blender files, especially for animations, is a great alternative to FBXs. Now let's make our slime character. First things first, let's make an empty game object and call it player. Make sure it's zeroed out so it's not messy. And then we'll pop the slime in there to make sure he's zeroed out. Then we're going to rotate the actual slime model, not the player object, negative 90 or 270 on the Y. Negative 90 is the same as 270. And now using the player object, we're going to create a player controller. There are actually two prominent ways to go about creating a character controller. There's Rigidbody and character controller. Now I'm going to use the character controller method because I feel like it would work better in this soccer game. The thing about character controller though is that it doesn't have any physics, so we're going to have to create scripts for everything. The first script we'll make is the player motor script, which will handle the movement and the gravity of our player. Now just because our player doesn't have a rigid body doesn't mean nothing can have a rigid body. We'll cover that later. So first let's do the player motor script. We'll drag it onto our player, and we're going to open in Visual Studio. Once we're in, the first thing I like to do is erase everything out. Let's get a clean slate here. We're going to have to declare some variables. First, I'm going to declare a variable. We have to access that character controller, so I'm going to put private character controller. And then with private variables, it's standard to use underscores. So I'm going to call it underscore controller, just to tell the difference quickly between a private and a public variable. Next, I'll create a serialized private float for move speed. We'll set it equal to 10. And then next variable will be a private vector 3. We'll call it move. Just to be sure, if you're following my style, all of these private variables have an underscore. Simple enough. Now we're going to call the start function and activate our controller. Controller, get component, character controller, not too hard. Then we'll go to the update function, and that's where we'll handle our direction finding. First, I'm going to create a float called horizontal, and then I'm going to use the input of the raw horizontal movement. That's basically just the A and D keys, or the left and right keys, to calculate the movement. And then I'm going to set the vector 3 move to equal a vector 3 with horizontal as the x, and 0 and 0 for the y and z. Since basically it's a 2D game, we're just going to be using x and y for our calculations. Now to simplify this, I'm just going to pop this in its own function, and I'm going to make a return of vector 3, and we'll call it calculate movement. So basically I'm going to have the calculations happen here, and then it's going to return the value of move. This is just a helper function. It's good practice to keep everything organized, and I also think it's good practice to create return functions that aren't just void all the time. It's good to understand what other functions do besides just the void functions. Next, I'm going to do the movement here. I'll use controller.move and pass in our move vector 3 and multiply it by move speed and time.delta time. The reason I'm doing the late update function is because it's called right after the update function. It's kind of like an order of operations thing. So we're calculating the movement first, and then we'll do the controller.move. So it's stricter for the update. And so now let's test it out. And there we go. We have our player moving. The speed is good. And now just to keep our update functions organized, I'm going to take this controller.move and put it in its own little function called move. And that's all for this video. Check out the next one where we'll handle the ground check for our character. Make sure you like and subscribe, and thanks for watching. Bye.